So, hey everyone, good morning. Welcome to this session. Quick introduction. My name is Ankit. I'm one of the co-founders of ClearTax. For the longest time, I've been a big fan of functional programming. Over 10 years of coding, I've been a huge fan of functional programming. But I never really had a chance to work with any functional language in production. In ClearTax, when we were actually launching a new product, that was a time when we got a chance to use F#, and I'm just going to talk about that story. I would not call myself really a great functional programmer yet. I'm still learning. It's a very long journey. The talk will be structured in high level. I'll first talk about the product we were building. What was the use case and why we ended up choosing F#? What was the reasons? Then during the initial development period, what things we saw which were useful for us and what stumbling blocks or roadblocks we hit. And as time went ahead, what did we learn and how did we improve the code base? And yeah, I'll summarize with some learnings as well. So the product I'm talking about is a site called cleartds.com. This is a B2B application for filing TDS returns. Very short introduction to the product. Anytime you get a salary, you have some tax deducted from it, right? So the company, the employer has to do a TDS return filing with the government. This is sort of a quarterly filing. And it is very critical in the sense that they have already deducted this money from your account. So if they don't report it to the government properly, basically it's a huge hassle for everyone involved. And not just from salary, but any sort of transactions. For example, even if you were, maybe if you are freelancing, can you get contract money on contract or something like that? You probably would have TDS deducted there as well. Okay, so this product is the first SaaS-based product for filing TDS returns in India. And we built it and launched it early 2014. This is before we got into YC. So back then the team was very small, basically. It was just 2-3 of us. So we decided to build this because it was a huge market need, that there were no good tools for this problem. But also while building this, ClearTax as a product was also there. This was the second product we launched. So I was just wanted to talk about the requirements of this product. TDS return filing software cannot be wrong, because if you make a mistake in a financial software, if you make a mistake in a tax software, it's a huge deal. Especially in TDS, because one TDS return may have thousands of people, right? And one mistake will lead to so many people suffering. So yeah, that is a huge, huge requirement. Accuracy is number one. The problem with accuracy here is that the TDS return format that is used to file a return with the government is a sort of very old, arcane file format, sort of from the mainframe days of programming. So it's like a flat file format with lot of weird inconsistencies. We'll go into that. And it's also not very well specified or well documented. So the next requirement is flexibility, because it's a quarterly cadence. Every quarter, you have to do a new return filing. And the rules typically change. They will have some new sections added, new rules added. Data format changes over time. So, and this is also very critical, because at least back then, every quarter they would announce a new file format or new changes to the file format, and it would be just immediately applicable. Okay, it is released on Monday and applicable from Monday. You have to add support as soon as possible. So that was a huge, huge problem. And finally, the other need we had was, since this was the second product we were building, we were not able to, keep it as a full-time focus for everyone involved. We had very few people. We had to move between products. After the initial sort of launch phase for a long period of time, it had a quarterly sort of wake up. Next quarter is coming in. You have to grab whatever changes, go into the code, make the relevant changes, do it correctly, and get out. So it was a product that needs something to be very simple to be able to get the context back into the system. If it is very complicated in nature, then you would spend some time, maybe a week, just understanding what you had done last quarter. So lack of engineering resources, number of people, lack of time, all of these are all the constraints we had. So the single largest constraint was the file format. So I've actually put a screenshot of the file format here. It's a text-based format. It has different types of lines. Each line has some mode. Each mode has different meanings. The meaning could change based on the time, in the sense that for which quarter this return is, or which type of return it is, salary return, non-salary return, and so on. And correction returns also have different formats. So it's a very weird format. And so the way they update the format also is like they had extra fields in the original format specification. Whenever new fields are added, they'll use an extra field is now meaning this. And if there are not extra fields, then some of the old fields that are no longer needed, they may replace that with the new one and so on. Since number of fields cannot change. So yeah, this is the format. So it was the sort of main blocker for us because we wanted to be able to do this very accurately. It is not something you can make a mistake on. And we tried a lot of different things to figure out, okay, what is the good option for this. Like we tried using very sort of procedural type code to read it and write it, but that was getting complicated. We tried to do DSLs, but like we didn't have really time to actually invest in this. We tried to use UI-based mapping tools, put tools on top of the format, but again, it was not working out very well. While doing this, I actually came across a feature of F# called type providers, and which really, really sort of helped me at that time. So, okay. Type providers, I think, are a feature that is F# specific right now. No other language has this, as far as I know. So it's a very interesting sort of way of metaprogramming. At compile time, you give the compiler a sample of some data format. So let's say it is a JSON format or XML or CSV. And you have a type provider for that specific type of format. In the case of us, it was like a CSV file format. So you have a type provider which understands what CSV files are, what delimiters and so on are. You give it a specific example. This is a CSV file I want to read. It will, at compile time, it will look at this data. It will generate types around it, saying, oh, this CSV file has 5 columns. This is a date, this is a string, this is a number, and so on. It will create a type around it automatically. And it would basically also give you parsing for free, in the sense that it will automatically grab the field names and everything from the header and generate a type. So, one second, I'll just do a quick demo of this because it's a very, very interesting feature. So, one second, can everyone see this? Okay. Okay, so I'm right now doing this in Visual Studio. Don't get alarmed. Okay, so this is a F# interactive script. I can basically write any code over here and I can send it to the interpreter, which it will evaluate and put it over here. This, I think, is small. Can anyone? Okay, all right. One second, let's see if it is required. Okay, so I've just done some setup over here, imported the sort of library for a JSON provider. What I want to do is, there is this sample file I have, which is a GitHub repositories JSON, like if you hit the GitHub's API for a single repository, this is the format that will come back. So it is sort of a nested structure with a lot of information. This is for the homebrew project. So it is nested in the sense that you have owner as a nested object. You have a lot of these things, and then you have some other nested objects again. So if you are going to build a GitHub client, for example, you need to support this format. Traditional approach would be you write this by hand. You write a class and then it converts to this and so on. And you annotate with the field name and everything. Okay. So what I'm doing over here is, I'm just saying that this GitHub provider is a JSON provider of this sample file. So I'm giving it the path to the sample file I have. And this path can actually be a URL. You can actually hit a remote URL and grab a sample at compile time. So the type provider also gives you some convenience methods, like from the sample data, it can give you the data back just to see what it is. So I'm getting the sample data back from this type provider. It is a fully typed object. So I can actually look at the fields inside the JSON. And even the nested fields are properly mapped into a object. So let me evaluate this. One second. Shortcut was not working. The keyboard shortcut was not working. It worked now. Okay. So, yeah. So from the sample, I can get that URL back. But I can also load a new instance of this. So for now, I'm just taking another text file. I'm just reading it into a string right now. So this one is a different file. This is for the F# project. Okay. So I'm reading this second JSON, and I'm just giving it to the parser. And so if I do this, the name over here is F#. So it basically took any other instance of this type of JSON and passed it into the proper fully typed object. And one very interesting implication of this is you can use this further in your application. Let's say that tomorrow GitHub's API specification changes, something changes. So let me go to the sample. Let me just change owner to author. Okay. So I've changed the sample file. GitHub has changed the specification for some reason. So when I reevaluate this, I say, so let me probably restart the interpreter. Correct. It's doing the right thing. So the what would happen is your code compilation would fail. So if you're using the old name and you recompile it, it will give you a compilation warning wherever it was used throughout your application. So changing formats will give you, compiler will directly say, "Hey, these five places are where you're using the old name," and you go and change them. So yeah, this was a CSV provider. But there are built-in providers for like CSV, XML, JSON, Excel files, a lot of different data types. There is even providers for SQL databases and so on. So it actually simplified our parsing a lot, because I could use that official documentation had some format. I could use that specification and put it in, and I could map it to my model very easily. In the code, I could actually see the exact name that is defined in the format. So I can trace it clearly. And the code readability was also great in this case. So we built this, the file handling part in F#. We tested it a lot. We had a simple strategy that you take sample files from some other software or government software, you put it into our system, parse it, parse data you generate it, do a line by line comparison, field by field comparison, see what fields differ. And you go back and fix it. So it was a very sort of iterative approach and worked very well. A lot of this was automated with F#. So the initial goal was to use F# mainly for this data part handling, because we found a great tool for it. But as we started working on it, we really liked the language, and it was working really well for our product problem domain. So we ended up writing the whole product in F# at that time. We didn't really have a focus of like making it a functional application or something like that. We were more pragmatic. We just wanted to get it done. F# gives you a lot of nice benefits, because it is like you can use it at any level you want. You can use it as a nicer version of C# if you want, or you can use it as a very high level functional programming language, depending on what systems you use. So the end application sort of was core application, the core components like the parsing, the validations, a lot of these business rules were written in F#. Top level mostly was again written in F#, but it was more of a standard imperative style, controller actions and so on. All the glue logic was more imperative. So yeah, this is sort of the philosophy we had with F#, be pragmatic. You are learning this language, you don't know it completely. So use whatever parts you know well, use them and try to get leverage wherever you can. But also, like, if you feel that there is a specific area where you, if you can invest time and learn and use that for greater leverage later, do that. So yeah, like, it's you can't really expect to learn a language very quickly, right? So our release schedule was very tight. We had like 6 to 8 weeks to launch, build the product, launch. So it was a very focused execution period. So we learned specific parts of the language and used them. And over time, like, we have actually gone back and changed some things which were not greatly, not well done. So mostly when we started out with F#, we used the basics like pattern matching, currying, pipelines, and so on. So I'll just give you a very, very short introduction about these things in case you're not familiar. So the pipeline operator in F# is actually a very simple operator. Its definition is as simple as pipeline of X and function. X is the data, is function applied with the data. So it sort of turns your code into a something like a Unix pipeline. You are giving data in the left, passing it to the function, passing it to the next function, and so on. So you can arbitrarily, you can have a very sort of long pipeline of like 3-4 operations like over here, and it just feels very natural. It's very easy to read. And for our business domain especially, it was very well suited for, because there were actually multiple stages of operations we had to do in sequence. So pattern matching, again, F# pattern matching is very powerful, especially because you can match on multiple values. You can match on a tuple of values. So if you have nested conditions, if this, do this, then look at other variable, look at some other variable. You have 3 top level variables. You can put everything in a single pattern match object and flatten it really into sort of a nicely readable decision tree almost. We might have gone a bit overboard, like even single case, if else, whatever, we ended up writing match everywhere. So, but yeah, it was a very, very useful feature for us. And so, as I was learning the language and building the product, I realized that partial application is actually a very, very nice way to encapsulate logic from one layer to another. So I can give you an example here that, okay, let's say that you want to do some validations. Validations are dependent on, in this case, validation requires you to specify year, quarter, return type, and the deduction. But at a high level, when I'm looking at it from a top level view, I just want to make, you know, for my UI, I want to give a function which says, okay, take this deduction, validate it. So I can freeze in the, you know, context dependent variables, year, quarter, and so on. I can give it a specific version, and I can get a function which is just going to take a tax deduction and validate that. So this was very useful for, like, okay, you have some low level code which is doing very specific things. At the top, if you want a generic type signature or something like that, you just give whatever you want to make it more general. The order of the parameters and everything really makes a difference though. So not sure if this is readable for everyone, but we also ended up like using very simple data structures to encode very complex rules for the, in this case, it was for the UI. So for the software, there were different modes of operation, different rules. If this field is editable, if the return is in this mode, otherwise it is not editable. Sometimes it is read-only, sometimes it is invisible, sometimes it is hidden, and so on. So we were able to just like write a UI spec in a very simple manner. So I'll just quickly run through this. Like, at the top, some type declarations. A column specification is expression, and a function which says whether the column is visible or not. Function which says whether the column is editable or not. And these things can be multiple functions because there could be multiple rules on top of it. So at the end, I can actually see, like, okay, for a UI, when I'm looking at a date field, the rule is for the rule for visibility is show it always. So show the date always and edit it always. But for some other field like session code, show it only for revised returns and only edit if it is null. and so on. So I could compose different conditions, put them very easily into a data structure like this, and have some other layer which is interpreting this data structure and creating the actual UI specification. So it's gave me a separation between the rules, how what should be done, from how it should be done, and made it much much simpler to implement and actually read also, because everything was not very closely coupled together. So while doing the implementation, one of the key requirements of this project was that it needs to be able to handle large amount of data, and like you have people coming in with, you know, the input could be from the UI, it could be from some third party system, payroll systems, it could be from Excel files or bulk uploads and so on. So you can have bulk inserts and lot of operations happening simultaneously. So we found a very nice ORM which was actually built for C#, which is almost like a SQL generator. So we wrote a very small wrapper on top of it to get it working nicely with F#, and this is in the end like how we are doing databases. So I'll give you an example over here. If I want to load a tax deduction by name, so I'm giving everything as a expression over here. So this syntax where I'm putting things in the angle brackets, it's basically an expression. This is a sort of special syntax in F# which actually keeps the expression tree in the memory instead of compiling it into a function. So I'm just giving a condition which is some predicate saying name equal to this given name, ordering for the SQL order by clause, and pagination. And given these three things, I could give it to a low level method which would generate the SQL like this, okay, select star from reduction with name equal to that and so on. So it really worked well at this level. But of course, like since you are in a very hurried schedule, there were some mistakes that we made. So I think one of the biggest mistakes we made was we didn't leverage type system of F# enough. So when I was learning the language, it was like the functional aspect was very, you know, very visible, how to compose functions, how to use these things, but how to use types properly was actually not very obvious. So we ended up like the data model was that there was one class, again we were using class because it was the ORM was a C# specific ORM which required a class instead of a F# specific type, and like this high level sort of model was used throughout, in the sense that for data storage, for business logic, for UI. So it was a common model across different layers. So code was pretty simple, but it polluted throughout. I can give you an example that since this ORM did not support F# specific types like discriminated unions or algebraic types, we had to use nullable values. If you are using nullable values throughout your code, now you are polluting it with this null. So the right thing to do would have been like separate it out into a layer and do different layers of types, but we didn't do that. That was the mistake. So that's the same. So yeah, like if we were actually doing a more of a, if I was starting this project now, I would spend a lot more time getting the types right and doing a more layered architecture instead of having same types used throughout. Some of the issues were sort of non-obvious. So in F#, sequence type specifically are lazy. So you have a long pipeline with some 8 different transformations and use it as a sequence. It's great because only if you're evaluating only 3 items from the sequence, only 3 items will be used. But it's also non-trivial because if you re-evaluate it, if you go from the beginning again, it is going to invoke everything again. It's not going to cache or memoize the results by default. So we didn't really realize this at first, and we were seeing a lot of the operations being repeated again and again. So we had to figure out like at what time do we use a sequence type or when do we use a list type. So there was a separation between sequence and list. List would evaluate and give me all the output, but now it is not lazy and so on. So it was a trade-off we had to make. We didn't really realize this at the initial stages. So one huge sort of performance issue we had that we realized after launching was we used these expression trees that I had shown you for database layer and so on very, very extensively throughout the code. because it is very useful that it is like a strongly typed expression where I can actually get the string name from that expression using some code. I can inspect this expression, I can see what nodes it connects to and so on. So for actually the generation of the file, the final TDS return file, I was using one expression per field per line. So this was working well for simple smaller use cases, but that these expression P's are actually pretty, pretty expensive to build. So they are like, I think last I had seen was like few hundred times slower than creating a normal lambda function. So when we were actually testing this and figuring out the usage, the profiler said 99.99% time is being spent only building these expression trees and evaluating them. So we actually removed it out from that part. Instead of expression trees, we use something else to get like 100% improvement in the code base. So, but the profiler actually helped us because we would not have realized this is the case without using a profiler. So this is also a sort of minor problem that we had to figure out which data structures to use. F# works on the CLR. It has its own sort of parallel data structures though. So a list in F# is different from a list in C#. F# implements sort of an immutable data structure and it's a linked list. And C# lists are different. They are array lists. Different namespace, different classes. So main issue was that again, third party libraries would expect a C# type, then you have to convert from F# to C#. And again, it's also, since a list was used throughout the code base and it's a linked list, some types of operations were much slower. So wherever required, we had to replace with an array or some other type. So yeah, we had tooling issues also. So this was back in 2014. The story is actually much nicer now. But like Visual Studio, we were using Windows and Visual Studio for developing this. The support for F# in Visual Studio is not as great as C#. It is slower, it crashes sometimes, it hangs up. One very interesting thing is F# projects do not allow cyclic dependencies. So the order in which you include files in the project matters. You can't, you know, if you have file A and file B, you can't refer file B from file A. You can refer only in the order they appear. That actually is a very nice feature because any time you open F# project, you can read through it in sequence and you can understand it completely instead of like jumping back and forth. And it makes the dependencies very clear. This is a dependency of this and so on. But like Visual Studio, for example, did not have an option for adding a file at a specific item. Every time it would add the item at the end. So we actually had to manually hand edit the project files and put it up and down and so on. So yeah, the F# tooling has improved in Visual Studio, and there is also much better tooling now for non-Windows users. So you have Atom and Visual Studio Code, and you have sort of cross-platform support for it. But it's still it's still not as good as the story you would have for IDE on C# or Java. Maybe it's getting there, but it's not as great. So one very interesting edge case we were always hitting into was F# compiler versions would update, and we often had this case that you write some code which works locally, you know, give it to a production box, it fails. And it was very, very annoying to figure out what is the cause, and usually ended up being a compiler version mismatch. Initial versions, so for most of Microsoft's tooling, originally what used to happen was that when you install a runtime, it would install at the global sort of system level. They moved to a local sort of package dependency thing, but again, it becomes sort of a little complicated to manage sometimes. So yeah, we used to run into this problem a lot earlier, better now. So, okay, as we started using the language, we figured out like different tools that the language gives us to actually write code in a better way. So one other interesting feature of F# is something that it calls computation expressions, which is sort of a syntactic sugar for monads, and I'm not going to go into detail there. So it's basically like when you define a computation expression, you define bind and return, two operations. And this, the sort of compiler translates it to a different syntax internally when it runs. So I can actually just explain with an example. So over here, this maybe you see is a computation expression. So maybe it's not a built-in expression, it's a thing that we build ourselves. But it's like everyone ends up writing this, takes this from Stack Overflow or somewhere and puts it in the code base in the end. So what this code basically does is, I want to calculate the late fine for some TDS if you've not done it on time. But you can only get the late fine if both dates are present, and both dates may not be present, they are option types. So credit date and TDS date, if they're not present, I can't get a late fine calculation, otherwise I can. So what this does is, inside the maybe, whenever I call this let exclamation, if that right hand side is none, it will fail at that point and it will return none at the top. So late fine also is an option at the end. It has some value or none. So this is basically almost the same as writing this. Okay, you are taking one value, matching it with none, then go ahead. Otherwise, again, go into it and so on. So this is much more harder to read. It is also very annoying to write. This is much simpler. And it can go to any level, basically. You have four variables which are optional. So this actually was very useful for our top level glue core, for controller level things where I'm getting data from parameters or from some data sources and deciding what to do. So this actually was great. But again, we used to have like a lot of nested conditions inside the controller logic because like F# will force you to pattern match on something if you don't cover all the cases. So if you have nested things, it would end up being like that. So we ended up flattening parts of it wherever suitable. So this was also a very interesting learning. Over time, as you matured with the language, the compiler is very smart. So it can do type inference, and you don't need to actually specify types. It will, based on usage, it will figure out, okay, this is a function that is adding two integers. So we didn't really, you know, annotate functions with types often initially. But as we started working on it over time, we realized that the type hints or the type annotations that we give are actually better suited for just reading it back. When you go back to that code after a few months, if you have annotated with the types properly, it's easier to understand what it does. Otherwise, like, you have to go to the IDE, mouse over it and see what it means and so on. So yeah, we started putting the annotations in manually. Also, we started doing type aliases, which is basically like, let's say I'm taking this combination often, like few things together in some tuple. So I can actually define a annotation which says okay, this type is equal to this combination of types. And it's much easier to talk about column specifications than saying this verbose thing. So yeah, another regret I have is that we didn't really use the algebraic types, the union types, well. So we mostly ended up at very leaf level in the data structure. Finally, this is either nullable or not, or something like that. But we could have used or leveraged the union types at a higher level. But mostly it was used at the leaf level. So yeah, this is something that we could have used better. So, okay. One very interesting insight is that we initially assumed that like getting people to work with F# would be hard, but it's actually not the case. We have three people working on this product right now. One person has some prior Haskell experience. One person has worked mainly with JavaScript, one is a college fresher, and everyone sort of ramped up and was able to contribute to the product very quickly. In-depth understanding will take some time, but it's actually a very easy language to learn and understand. And I'm really glad that someone learned F# as the first language to work with. So finally, like it's regardless of what language you use, it ends up being that the way you structure the application really matters. The design of the application matters. So regardless of what language you use, you can write a bad application in F# and write a very good application in C. So like good design is always going to be useful, and that works independent of language. And wherever we sort of made shortcuts or took shortcuts, even in the F# project, finally we had to go and fix them. But functional languages will help you make right choices along the way because they give you more tools. They have all these tuple types and discriminated unit types and so on. So, okay. So, when we started the, again, most of the libraries we were using were C# specific libraries, since F# was still very young. But now it's actually a different situation. There are projects which use F# as the first class citizen. And you don't really need to make some of the suboptimal choices we made earlier. Now, there are F# specific ORMs and a lot of these things available at present. Okay, so right now F# is being used. The whole TDS product was completely built in F#, and inside ClearTax also some features are running on F#. Most of it is still C# because we were not able to. Basically, it's a tooling issue. We couldn't mix and match two languages in the same project inside. So it was either like rewrite everything into a new language or continue working on the same. So it's not really a huge win. But like some of the other interesting things we did with F# was there is like a canopy, which is a DSL over Selenium. So you are able to write browser tests very easily in F#. So yeah, that's it. Any questions? Actually, we're using the CSV type provider, because CSV provider, I can just say use caret as a separator. Well, number of fields was different, and we had to figure out the type. So first we had a layer on top saying, okay, if this is of some type, go to this provider and so on. So we had the logic at the top layer, which would distribute across the type providers. What? No. And you can actually provide the hints to the type provider. At least in the CSV provider, the file headers, you can put a hint saying that this is supposed to be a string or this is supposed to be an int, and it will try to coerce it to that. Yeah. Yes, but again, like if it can't parse it, you probably want to take it as a string, and because you don't know which format it is you're going to use in the end. MMDD, YYDD, MMYY, ISO format, and so on. So like these three people are working on this project full time. The whole engineering team right now is around 16 people. We have like ClearTax is mostly C#, and some of the projects are Java. So it's yeah. So initially, like mostly it was a server-side rendered application, but all the CRUD aspects were being taken over by JavaScript. It was like a grid-based interface, something like Excel, because it has huge amount of data. We don't want to create one by one entry. So we had a JavaScript library in the front end, which would render it in a grid. And communication was like JSON from client to server. So this is on the, so when I evaluate this with a given year, given quarter, given TDS return type as an input, I will get a JSON specification back. There was a separate layer which was just going over this, running these things and getting a specification for the UI. So it's a function. So show always is a function which would take in some specification, year, quarter, and so on, and return bool. Correct. So just like editing, for example, I actually gave some example. Edit always is function takes a deduction, returns true always. So on. So it was going to, so there was a separate layer which would go through this data structure, call the functions one by one. And like there would be, if there are multiple functions, it would take a combination. This is being done on the server side. The server side would evaluate this for a specific instance. If you are working on 2016 quarter three something, then it would evaluate this, figure out what is required, and create a JSON specification as output. JSON specification would be used by the front end to actually create the fields. Hmm. So we still don't use types as well as I want, because it would require spending time rewriting large parts of the application. So it's a gradual process still. It's not that difficult, but for the longest time, basically, it was not a product which had fixed people working on it. Only recently, we have now 3 people working on it. For the longest time, it was. We were focusing on ClearTax, the filing product, and then on this once in a quarter and so on. So it was like, if we had time and resources, we would have made a lot of changes. But by now, we have people working on it full time. So we are actually seeing a faster rate of improvement. Every quarter. So every quarter, every 3 months, it would change. Sometimes the changes are very small, in the sense that one field is added or some field is marked optional. Sometimes it's like very big changes. This type is no longer allowed and we are using this and so on. So every quarter it can be a toss, whether it is a small change or a big change. So the government would release the sort of thing in the Excel file format. Okay, this is Excel which contains all the fields and so on. So you would take that, put it in the sample specification, and when you compile, it will tell you where it is breaking. Additional fields, at least, yeah. But existing fields, if they are removed, they will be automatically highlighted. Additional fields, you have to add yourself. Yes. So we don't really need to maintain history, because once the government goes to a new version, they will also stop supporting old versions. So in this case, it was, we didn't need to maintain versions of it. No, like in not the actual statements, the data, yes, but not the statements. Like 1 quarter. Okay. So Abhiranjan is also from my team. You can actually chat with him later if you want. Any question? So we didn't ship a bug in the file parsing, which I'm very happy with. So that is the main thing. Like in the sort of glue layers or whatever, UI states and sort of that type of messy code, we have shipped bugs. Yes, and but not seen a huge amount of difference at that layer, but in the core business logic, it has definitely helped. Okay. Anyone else? No. How are they different from? So, okay. Let me see if I can just show it here. So this is a very simple lambda function. Okay, add is a function which takes 2 integers and returns a sum. If I do, so this guy is a expression, it is a quotation of expression of this expression. So using this, I can actually, what was it, I probably need to import some. So the type of add is a function which is going to take integer, return a function which takes integer and returns. This one is a quotation expression of that same type. So I can invoke A, but I can also go inside the A's expression tree and I can see the nodes, the expression nodes, and I can go into it and see runtime. So yeah, the expression tree is available at runtime. You can go into it and see what is there. runs on the CLR, and CLR will keep the generic type information. Yes. Otherwise, this is a compiled unit goes into the. It made things nicer. Like I was able to write very readable code, so we used that. We didn't realize the cost. So when we saw it is so slow, we had to remove it and use a. So mostly when you have an expression like this, right? Typically, what we ended up doing was, let's say you have a type, GitHub provider or something, type or anywhere. So we mostly ended up using expression tree as an accessor, in the sense that given an object, give me some property of that object. So using that, basically I can get the, when I evaluate this expression or go into it, I can get this length property as a string. I can get that name back. So for generating SQL or mapping to JSON or something like that, you can take that name of that expression, name of the property, and use it somewhere else. And you get the benefit of static typed thing over here. You, as well as at runtime, you get the actual sort of name. So it's similar to reflection almost in our use case. But you can do a lot of things. You can actually build these expressions at runtime also. You can compose or create the expression tree at runtime. You can evaluate it and so on. Okay. Anything else? Let's try. Let me verify. I'm not 100% sure. There is a package I have to import, which gives me a way to invoke. Can't remember. System.runtime.something. Microsoft. Anyway, if I can remember. Quotations. Something. I can't remember it. All right. So I think we are done with the questions. We can catch up outside also and go over anything in detail you guys want. All right. So look, thanks a lot. Yeah. So yeah, you can reach me on Twitter if you want, or email Ankit@ClearTax. All right.